Shalom. This week we are reading Parshat Chukat. You know, there's nothing worse than someone who doesn't show appreciation. But actually, there is one thing worse, and that is someone who, instead of showing appreciation, turns the whole thing on their head and takes the very instrument of appreciation that they should be thankful for, and instead blames his benefactor for everything that's happened because of the good thing that he's done. This scenario actually has a biblical ring to it from the very, very beginning, because when we think about Parshat Bereshit, we remember that when Hashem said to Adam HaRishon, "Did you eat from the tree that I commanded you not to eat?" What was the very first thing that Adam said? "The woman that you gave me to be with me, she gave me of the fruit of the tree, and I ate." So, that whole feeling, that scenario, seems to be maybe repeating itself a little bit here, also in our parsha, Parshat Chukat. Especially when we consider the fact that everything that the generation of the desert is going through, as we've emphasized, is part of the tikkun of Am Yisrael, part of the preparation, the rectification of the nation getting ready to accept its responsibility, and also, in a broader sense, it's part of the tikkun of Adam in general, everything that's going on there in that controlled environment in the desert. So here in Parshat Chukat, we read about this incident that occurred in chapter 21, where the spirit of the people grew short on the way, and they began once again to complain. The people spoke against God and Moshe, and they said, "Why did you bring us up from Egypt to die in this wilderness? For there is no food and no water, and our soul is disgusted with this insubstantial food." So here, of course, where do we begin looking at this statement where God took them out of Egypt, brought them on their way to the land of Israel, to the promised land, and in the meantime is feeding them from his table, as it were, bread from heaven, this man, which has no physical counterpart whatsoever, which has no byproduct, which has nothing negative associated with it whatsoever, because it was a type of spiritual diet where God was already beginning to prepare them for their lives by keeping them so pure and getting them ready for this awesome task. And their relationship in the desert during those years was so high, their connection to God was so pure, the only thing they'd be able to tolerate was this perfect food, this manna, which was like the physical representation of the ratzon, of God's will, of his desire for his people. But, as our sages tell us, it produced no waste product. The generation of the desert, the Israelites in the desert, did not have to relieve themselves during that entire period, and therefore they looked at themselves and they said, "We're not living lives like people," and looking for an excuse, they said, "This can't be right. Something wrong with this picture. If you eat food, you should afterwards have to take care of these basic needs." And instead of realizing what Hashem was doing for them, the level that he was keeping them on, the tremendous significance of this relationship, instead they took that very gift, the man and their situation in the desert, and they turned it completely on its head. And that very act of kindness, that very process of closeness that God was bestowing on them, this is what they, instead, like Adam HaRishon said, "Oh, this is what you do to me, this is what you gave me." So, getting back to that Edenic parallel, seeing as how the complaint of the Israelites so much hearkens unto that original response of Adam HaRishon, "It's your fault because you gave her to me." So we have another parallel to the story of Gan Eden. We have another throwback to that earlier scenario. We have the punishments inflicted upon the people through the agency of some sort of snake. Once again, we see the serpent is involved. God sent the fiery serpents against the people, and they bit the people, and a large multitude of Israel died. What is the significance of this concept of these Nechashim, the serpents that were sent against the people? Why specifically were these serpents used as an element of retribution? The more we understand this incident, the more we can appreciate the fact that the major issue here was the aspect of Lashon Hara, the aspect of evil speech that the people spoke now against God and against Moshe. And that element of Lashon Hara is very much reminiscent of the Lashon Hara spoken originally by the first master of Lashon Hara, who was the snake, who spoke actually to Chava and intimated to her that God has some sort of agenda here, that God doesn't want you to eat from the fruit of the tree, because if you eat from it, then you'll be like him. And he spoke against God, and ultimately Chava and Adam also spoke against God. So the serpent is the vehicle, as it were, the agent of retribution, since they did not learn their lesson from the Lashon Hara spoken by Adam against Hashem. Thus, the one who started the Lashon Hara, the one who started the evil speech, is the one who comes now to take retribution against those who continue that. Not only this, but our sages point out that the serpent eats many things, but everything that he tastes, tastes like dust in his mouth, even if he eats all of the pleasures in the world. Whereas in the desert, the people ate the manna, which could taste like anything, like all the pleasures in the world, but they complained that it was insubstantial. So let the serpent, who eats many things, but who can only taste dust, come and exact retribution, payment from those who eat one thing that really could taste like many. And as God told the snake, you will eat from the dust your whole life. We don't find any record of him complaining about that. He accepted that judgment. But yet, this generation was complaining. The generation of the desert lived completely protected and nurtured, and they were provided for completely by God. All their needs, all they had to do was open up their eyes and look around them and learn to appreciate everything. And indeed, one of the greatest tikkunim for the generation of the desert, and indeed one of the greatest tikkunim for all the descendants of Adam, is for us to learn to appreciate everything that Hashem gives us.